Always with guys.
Always. Those are some of the best guys in the North End.
Yeah, yeah.
With some of the worst guys to some people, but the best guys to us. We were just talking off camera, everybody. You don't need to know what we're talking about. But this is North End Stories. I'm here with Bobby right here. Bobby runs the coffee shop, Polcari's coffee
shop.
Bobby,
let me ask you a question.
So, with your coffee, like, what do you know about coffee? Give me your gist about the coffee bean,
I know coffee gives you energy.
Right.
You know, coffee's got, you've got two types of coffee. You've got an Arabica coffee, you've got a Robusta.
Yeah.
Robusta coffee is grown at lower altitudes and has a high content.
So coffee's a bean, I mean, right?
Yeah,
grows in hills and mountains, when you say higher altitudes?
Yeah.
You can't grow it like on a flat surface, right?
No, you can. There's some that's grown low, there's some that's grown high.
Okay.
The stuff that's grown high, that's the good stuff, you know? That's the stuff that's got less caffeine and more taste. And the coffee that's grown lower altitudes is the coffee that is got almost twice the amount of caffeine and less taste.
So you have more of a kick.
Yeah.
So that'll keep you going. It's something you want to drink. That kind of a coffee you want to drink if you're working two jobs, three jobs. Where did the espresso come from? Give me the idea. Yeah. Like, I know it's an Italian coffee and whatnot. I know it's a strong coffee. But who discovered it? Do you know? I mean, who decided that we're going to make it into a small form, a short form, if you will?
Well, as you know, coffee was not, it doesn't come from Italy.
Okay.
They do not grow coffee in Italy.
Okay.
We do grow it here in America, one place, Hawaii.
You're kidding
me. But the Italians, they take something and they make it the best.
All right.
So they weren't the first ones to grow coffee.
Okay.
To roast coffee.
They put their stamp on it?
Yeah, they put
words,
their stamp on it.
Okay.
And like you know, Anthony, being of Italian descent, no one does it like the Italians.
Right, hey, you say that again, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So.
But the Italians make espresso, and we drink it in small quantities, not like these big American coffees you see here.
Right, right.
Give me the big gulp.
So so it's not about the quantity, it's
about the quality.
My man, that's what I'm talking about here. Everyone, this is a delicious espresso. If you could take a look at it, it's got a little bit of, what do you call the top
crema,
of it?
Crema.
The crema. Ooh, it's like my grandma, you know what I'm saying? But
it was delicious.
God bless.
Thank you so much.
I noticed these here, Bobby, and these look pretty damn old. Give me a little background on what they are, how old they are, and what they're used for.
These are close to 100 years old. These are brass bins that were manufactured to house coffee.
Now, they don't make these anymore, right, Bobby?
No, I went to Home Depot. They looked at me like I had three heads, right? But look at here. You got Italian roast, and this is something that I store. We're moving a lot of this bean. This is a power punch.
Okay, it's a kicker in the
morning. Italian roast, a.k.a. espresso.
And so these would keep the roasted beans in here?
Yeah,
When you get the coffee bean itself, Bob, you have to roast it to get it to a certain form, like half? Like, in other words, you don't get a bean, like, from the plant itself, the coffee, how does it work?
I got green beans right around the corner here.
And
you'll check those out. Those are raw. So, you gotta know what you're doing. Roasting is oil. There's natural oil in coffee. And the longer you roast your coffee, those oils come out. So if you roast a coffee light, and I can show you a light one. The light one is dry looking. But the more oil, the more you roast it, the more oil comes to the surface.
The more slicker it may be. Look how oily
and beautiful
this is.
That's
why I noticed that, because I remember as a kid, when I would work in coffee shops, and I would do the old Father, Son, Holy Ghost in an espresso with the coffee beans.
Yes.
My fingers would always have a little something on there.
Oh, yeah. The oil here.
Excellent.
It the grease? It was the oil.
That's awesome. Thank you, Bobby.
So we talked about the green beans you mentioned, Bobby, when we talk about the coffee bins. And let's go back over, what did you mean by the green beans?
These are raw green coffee beans from Uganda.
From Uganda.
Yes.
And they're imported, obviously.
Two beans come in a berry.
A berry?
Yes, a berry, a red berry.
So it's not like I think of a coffee like a little red seed, but it's not, it's a berry.
It comes in a berry.
So you break the berry apart and you find two little seeds.
Two seeds like this, unless it's a pea berry.
Okay.
You know what that means? That means one instead of two.
Oh, shit.
And that's an unusual thing, but it's out there.
Wow, that's wild.
But two is the norm.
Okay. And that kind of, when you make coffee, you would grind it into like a fine powder, like the coffee that we would buy, say, a Maxwell House, God forbid.
Yeah.
And you would make an espresso or just a regular cup of coffee with it.
Yes,
right?
So you get these raw, they're roasted.
What would the color roasted. Be, Bobby? Because it's a green bean. Is it like, coffee normally is a brown color. Would it be like almost like a tea, a green tea look?
Well, you know what? We're going to go to the next step.
Okay.
And we're going to show you the light and the dark. And we'll see
the differences
all the varieties. Yeah, all the varieties and the stages.
Damn, all this coffee I'm drinking today, I'm going to be up for like a fucking month. But hey.
We're not going to sleep for weeks.
Nobody ever said I didn't have any energy. I'm just saying, but a boom and a bang. So now, as you can see, look. Even the...
Yeah. So here we are again, obviously, Polcari's coffee shop. So I noticed when I was a little boy, you know, I never really came in here. I mean, I would come out here and we'd get the slush. You know, the slush was obviously the number one. We'll get into that later in the show. But when I first came in here, my Uncle Sal asked me to go get some seeds. You know, he was a green thumb. And they had seeds in here. I didn't know that. But when I walked in, it's the smell. The smell is, it's the same smell I smell now that I smelled then. It's a combination of coffee, but candy as well. There's a sweetness to it. And there's a lot of spices and ingredients and stuff involved in this place or sold in this place. And as you can see right here, all these different spices. I asked myself, why would somebody buy these, which seems like, you know, you have to weigh them or whatnot to get whatever amount you need, as opposed to going to a store like buying, say, salt and pepper. Bobby, why would somebody come in here?
Great question. Why would they buy these as opposed to the ones in the supermarket? Well, for starters, the ones in the supermarket have been there for God knows how long. Years and years and years. They're manufactured, put in a jar.
By machines, not by people.
Waiting for their chance to be displayed.
No love when people make this is true.
Then they're sitting on the shelf, goes God knows how long. Ginger. Here's a perfect example. Ground ginger. Now this ground ginger, if you could smell it, we're not there yet, but if you could smell it over the camera, oh my God, it's fresh.
It's powdery.
And I'm moving this stuff. Right. We're moving these spices.
So how do you sell something like that, Bobby? You put it in a little container?
We put in a little bag. You can buy a small amount.
That's wild.
Buy a little amount. We're in the supermarket. You gotta buy 2, 3, 4 ounces.
So if you just wanted to bake a small amount, say just one cake for the day, you could buy just enough that you needed.
Exactly.
And you won't mind. It wouldn't be like, oh, I'm not selling this, it's too little. No. Right.
And look at $1 an ounce. You go to the supermarket,
$1 an ounce.
They're gonna rob you.
So it's pretty impressive. Now this stuff is grinded or grounded here?
Yeah. No, I do grind some of my spices here.
Right.
This particular one, no. But I'll show you, we have a cinnamon. Ground cinnamon.
Ooh, cinnamon. We all like cinnamon,
right? This one's from Ceylon. Can we move down here, Anthony?
Yeah, let's move it. Let's get a shot. Look at this place. You cannot find a spot to put a toothbrush, let alone like a hat or a jacket. As you can see, my jacket's like over here, like on all these spices and stuff. Like it's gonna smell good.
Better than ever.
I wish I'd smell better than ever, but anyway.
You smell all right, Anthony.
So let's go back to the cinnamon. Right.
So here's a cinnamon stick. Now this is a different species of cinnamon.
Wow.
Not typical. Okay. So we got this cinnamon, and then we got this cinnamon right here. Right.
What's the
two different species?
You can
here,
see they're
right?
different. There's right? a different yeah. color of them.
Yeah, look at that.
Obviously, the size is
different
a lot
box.
Different.
Now,
so go ahead, Bobby. I'm sorry.
No, cinnamon is a bark of a tree. You've got the soft cinnamon, the cinnamon from Ceylon, from Sri Lanka, and then you've got the one here on the left. That's a dark cinnamon from the Far East.
Wow.
And they're two different cinnamons. You smell them both. They smell different. This one smells fruity.
It's crazy.
And this one is your typical cinnamon here.
There's a price difference,
of course.
Right, yes. Right. The better quality, the more expensive it's going to be. But if you want the best, it's going to cost you.
If you want the best, it's going to cost a little bit more.
If I may, there's people walking by. They think we're open right now. This is how crazy this place is. It's that busy, believe me.
Anthony, we are open. We're open-minded.
Hey, I like that. Wow. At least somebody's open-minded about me and my show.
Yeah.
But, you know,
if
somebody watches.
Your show's the bomb.
Yeah, we'll see. You're making it the bomb right now, Bobby. Thank you so much. That's very interesting. And wow, what knowledge you're putting on my head.
Thank you.
I feel honored to be on your show.
Bobby, I really do, from the heart.
You are the show.
From the ticker.
The neighborhood is the show. The people are the show. You are the show. So the show thanks you.
The show must go on.
Yes, and it will. We got some of this candy here. I remember as a kid, these Italian candies. My grandmother always had them over the house. So, Bobby, tell me about some of these things.
We got Toroni. Toroni's a very popular Italian sweet.
Yeah, I remember those.
I'm a huge fan. You got pistachio, my favorite.
Are these made with like an anisette or something? I always feel like there was some kind of alcohol in them.
No booze. I would know it, believe me.
Right.
I know booze.
Bobby's half Irish and half Italian.
Just saying.
So he's got the best of both worlds.
We're drinkers. So you got amaretto, you got pistachio,
You got this one, coffee, nice. Coffee beans in there. I love eating coffee beans. You can drink them, right. You can eat them, yeah, you can throw them.
Yeah, on the sneak, when you weren't looking, I don't want to say that it's cold, but I grabbed one and I kind of popped it in.
Nice. Old school, Anthony. You are old school all the way.
I'm old, that's for sure.
Right? Toroni, very popular. Nice. Then we got panettones.
Yeah, panettone. I remember them as a kid, too. It's a
sweet bread.
It's for coffee, right?
Yeah,
coffee, it's not like a dessert. Yeah. It's more like something that it's like accompanies a cup of coffee.
It is. It's great. I tell you, if you've ever made French toast with panettone, saporito, it's delicious.
Hey, what is it called again?
Saporito.
Wow, he says it so well.
Delicious, right?
I'm a little turned on right now.
Yeah. And then you got the little panettones, the kid-size ones. And then, let's see, we get pistachios, all kinds of nuts, almonds.
We got two nuts right here.
All right, you better be. Right, hazelnuts, the confetti almonds.
Oh, remember those?
These are great.
You get those in weddings a lot, am I right? I always see them. Why in a wedding? Is there a reason for that?
Yeah. Jordan almonds. Right. Almond is like a small egg. And a small egg is fertility. And that's fertility. That's where that ancient custom comes
that's
from.
That's insane. Wow. Yeah. I just learned something again.
And then the numbers. They put 3, they put 5, they put 7. If you put 3, you know what the people around the table are saying?
No.
They're saying, look how cheap, just 3 almonds.
But right? What does it mean?
Right. Well, it's a symbol of fertility. So the number is just the quantity. It has to be an odd number because you know us, we're odd. The Italians, right? It's going to be an odd number.
Well done.
Right? But put 5, they won't talk about you. 7, they'll say, wow, meet you. Seven almonds, right?
Bobby, talk to me about these. I remember these as a kid.
Very good. So you'll see these at our festivals, right?
Right. Like, all the time. The feast. They used to have it when I was a kid. There was always a guy that sold like roasted peanuts or cashews. Like, I had a little bins of all these. And then they had these little things. And
they're chickpeas. So these are chickpeas that are roasted. Right. You get different variety here. You get the soft. You get the hard salted.
Nice.
The soft salted. And then you get these too. You've seen these.
Yeah.
With that guy selling the sementis, the salted seeds.
Nice.
So these seeds are great Italian snacks.
That's awesome.
And you know, there's no sugar in them, which is great. And I'm a fan of that because we're sweet enough, aren't
we? Yeah, if you tasted me, you'd know. Oh, I'm just saying. Thing is, chigidis, I've never really known what they were. I remember getting them as a kid. I had a few of them, but really, we should just use them to like throw at each other. Now that I learned about chigidis, you can appreciate the little things.
Protein.
Little things about the knot that I love. That represents.
It's so true. And here's another one. This is licorice. Licorizia. Right.
Like the black licorice.
Black licorice. Yeah. And I love licorice. You either love licorice or you hate it.
I like licorice, but not the black licorice. Yeah. It makes me, it feels like Zambuca to me.
Yeah. That's why I like it.
Yeah, well, I wonder why. That's the Irish in him talking right there. Wow. God bless. That's beautiful. Bobby, thank you again.
My pleasure.
World of knowledge. Not that stories. Polcari's. Best ever.
It's remarkable, all these pictures. So now Ralph was, he was related to Polcari. He was his son.
Yes.
All right.
Yep.
And you were what, just a kid when you started here? How did you get this job? Where did this come from?
I was 17 years old when I started here, but 2 years before that, my great friend Anthony Belia, he got me the job down the street.
Was there a picture? Is this him right here?
Here's Anthony right here,
Oh, you guys are young. What year was that? 97 right there. So go ahead.
Yeah, he gets me the job.
And you just wanted to have a job?
Yeah, I just wanted a job. I was a musician.
Gotcha.
And I wanted a job, and he
didn't matter that it wasn't like you were into coffee.
No,
you just wanted a job. How old were you at the time?
I was, when I started here, 17 years
17
old.
17 years
so
old.
So I was pushing a broom and learning the ropes.
And what are you now, 38?
you're kind, 54 now.
54,
this old tank
him.
Here.
Nice.
I feel very fortunate to have been... have a friend like Anthony to get me the job here, and to work alongside of Mr. Polcari. What an honor that was! And the information. A lot of guys go to college.
Right.
This was my institution.
This
right
was
here.
Your school right
this
here,
was
right?
My, this was my school.
And
here.
You learned a lot here, Bobby. How long have you been running this? Now you took over in what year?
2001.
2001.
I took it over.
Wow.
Yeah.
Have you been here since what year when you started? When you were 17?
I started here 1984.
84. Yeah. Wow. So that's 37 years ago.
Good math.
Damn. Pretty damn impressive, Bobby. And this place really hasn't changed much. I mean, you put your own touches on it because your own touches were passed through generation from generation. So the touches that you put on them are the touches that they actually put on
this place because you learned from them.
Yes, and the Board of Health. Every once in a while they come around, they say, we don't like this, you're going to change it.
Right. And there's so much in here, so much stock that, wow, if you had to change something, you probably have to change everything. It's like a domino effect, the way things are displayed. True. It's incredible. Really, very impressive, Bobby. The North End loves you. God bless you, man.
I love the North End.
Tell me the story behind this. What do you call this?
Anthony, this is the Wall of Fame.
Okay.
And this is a historical, a lot of pictures, like you see, the founder, Anthony Polcari, right here.
Okay.
Anthony comes from Italy. He's 20 years old. He's a tailor. He wants to go into business. His dream is to go into business. He makes money as a tailor. During the Depression, he opens up a business.
Look how sharp he looks there. Look sharp, at the difference. Look at the outfits they wore back then, huh?
We dress in t-shirts, Anthony.
Right, right.
He was in suit and jacket. Look at him.
Sharp as a nail.
Right?
Absolutely.
He has two. He has three children, okay. Ralph, Anthony, and Marie, right here.
Right. And Ralph, when you say Ralph, is that the Ralph that you owned this when I was
Yes, that's the Ralph.
Ralph's the same guy that when I would buy a slush would be like, hey, Skid.
Yeah, that's
He would always say Skid. Yeah, I was like, what's up with the Skid? Does he not know that it's Kid?
Yeah, Ralph had his own language.
And, it was weird.
And the boys, you know, the boys that had worked before me here, Louis, Pasquale, and Anthony, they'll tell you all these Ralphs. He had boys that worked here, and the boys, Louis, Anthony,
that's
had
a great picture Attilio, right there, Ralph, right there, huh?
Yeah, Angelo.
World. That's him when he was young right here?
Yes, that's him.
I'm
that's
sorry,
him.
Bobby. I'm
no,
cutting you off.
That's
just,
him 17 years old.
I see all these pictures here. I get a little excited.
There's a lot going on, right? Here's Ralph as a mature guy, a mature person right there. Also here with my cousin Nikki. A nice picture there.
So you have a couple of kids, right? Over here, you mentioned this right here is your daughter,
that's
correct?
That's my daughter, Brooke. Yeah, that's a picture there. That's the before and after. That's her as a one and change little girl, and that's her as a young lady.
Nice. Yeah?
And I got my son Bobby up top there. That's a
Bobby Jr.?
Bobby, he's Bobby. He's got a different middle name, Fitzgerald. Okay. His we went to a Bruins game there. That's a Stanley Cup game. Very proud of that game with my boy.
You can see he's a huge, huge Bruins fan, huh?
I like the bees. I like the buzz.
How could you not? As I get myself comfortable, we are underneath Polcari's coffee shop. This barrel right here, I don't know if the word is barrel. I don't want to call it that, but it contained the slush. The famous lemon slush that we all loved as a kid and is now inbred in our bodies and souls. And to me, Richie who? Slush, when I think of slush, this is what I think of, homemade slush. Bobby, what is the actual term? Is there a term for this device here?
It's a slush barrel.
It's a slush
custom,
barrel.
Custom slush barrel. Wooden barrel. Stainless steel. Cover.
Where do you buy something like this?
This has to be made.
Handmade.
Handmade. This was handmade. The top.
The handle on it.
The cover, the cylinder, the houses the slush.
Good old fashioned American.
This scoop here, you can buy this anywhere, the scoop right now.
But how old would you say this? Because I know I'm 52 years old. I know I don't look it. But I'm just saying, I know this was around when I was a child, 40, 50 years ago. So how old is this approximately?
This barrel is going to be close to 70 years old.
70 years old.
Yeah,
wow.
These barrels. Because they were made and they were here. And this particular barrel, I remember before it was painted green.
It looks exactly the same. Right.
Yeah. And we painted all our barrels North End green. That color.
Why not? Yeah. Why do you say that?
Well, I would say North End green because that green, this green, I don't know if it's Hunter green or Money green or whatever the color is. You see a lot of storefronts that were painted green. You know, one of our three colors in the Italian flag.
Travesty green.
Right,
absolutely.
The green is there.
Those are our colors.
Right, and that's why North End green, I always say that.
So let me ask you this now. It started off as obviously a coffee shop. When did the slush get involved and where did it come from?
That's great history there too. So the coffee store was there.
Right.
You know, and
did Ralph come up with this?
No, his father. His father did, yeah.
The original.
Yeah. His father, Anthony Polcari, came up with the idea to sell slush in here. And many stores did carry slush.
Right.
But, you know, being at the corner and having our location, we became popular. So the barrel was outdoors, right. It was outside. Back then, you could be outside.
Yes, because I remember it being right in front of the door.
Yeah, and certain guys.
With a little sign that said it was like a quarter for a small, 50 cents for a medium, 75 for a large when I was a kid.
Yeah, right, we had
obviously,
that.
Obviously, prices have probably changed. Oh. But so it was a lemon slush.
Yeah, always lemon. Homemade. One flavor. You know, visitors would come in. What kind of flavor slush do you have? And we'd say, we got three. Right. Lemon, and lemon. What flavor do you want? Oh, I'll take lemon. Good choice, sir. Yeah. You know? But there's always lemon. Lemon, there's a acidity in lemon that fights off bacteria.
It's funny, you know, lemon, when you think of slush, it must have been like the first flavor, it sounds like that. It
had to be.
Right? Because I never heard of an orange slush. Lemon is always like that genuine beginning original flavor, and then as time went on, people must have created different ways to make different flavors.
That's true, but you're right. Lemon, you pick a lemon from a tree.
Right, it's easily done.
Right, you squeeze it, you're there.
So think about Italians. A lot of our food derives from, like, I don't want to say being poor, but maybe it might have been over the course of history. You know, Italy and Sicily were taken over by so many different countries that we were like probably starved and whatnot. So, you know, what do? You make what you can. So, you know, tomatoes, cheap. Bread, think about it. You make pizza, you make pasta. You know, it's inexpensive, but in the end, when it comes to like desperation, you end up making in love, especially to feed your family, things that throughout the history today, pizza, pasta, meatballs, gravy is one of the most loved meals that Italy has ever given the world.
I remember this is like, you take the cover off. It's like, how does this lift up?
Yeah, that lifts up now.
And now
there's the original cylinder right here.
Right.
And then we went down.
So there was just that
piece,
much. That's all the slush that would go in there.
No, it was twice the size.
Twice the size. But I mean, it's really this much.
Yes.
Wow, I thought the whole barrel. Was actually filled with slush.
You know
which is weird.
Originally, the cylinder is much deeper, but I.
You had a because of the.
I tweaked it a little bit.
Right.
Because it was tough to scoop, to go
way
down.
Do you get a lot of people that know they used to have slush since the barrel is in
outside?
People know that the slush is still here?
You know,
is it generally not them people? Or?
Yeah, it's people that were in the know,
right.
Like yourself.
Right.
And I do put a sign out
right.
in front. Now I've got a wooden sign that's painted, lemon slush.
To let people know that don't know.
Yeah.
And what happens when I'm curious to know, somebody that never had it.
Yeah.
You know, people from all over come here, and they're not that it's a famous place for all different reasons. And they come and they try your slush. What's the first thing they say?
They're amazed, first of all. You got one flavor, that's
right.
it? One flavor? Yeah,
because
lemon,
today
that's
it's
it.
Everything,
So we make one flavor, and we make it fresh every day.
Right.
And that's the secret.
Every
of,
day,
you know,
think about it. Every
I won't mention
day.
Any names.
Right.
You know, Richie, et cetera,
yeah.
blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
But big slush companies, and they've done well, good for them. But they're making, 10, 20 flavors.
Yeah, right.
So and guess what? Those flavors are sitting in a freezer.
Yeah.
They're sitting in,
oh,
and
I've
they
had,
change.
Like, yeah, I've
but
had when,
right?
older ones, whatnot, that just don't have the same flavor.
All the flavor drips to the bottom.
Yeah, it's more like,
so it's tough. It's more ice chip. Yeah.
Yeah,
that's what it is. With ours, it's granule, so we take the water and we stop it before it turns to ice.
Okay.
So it's granule there, the sugar.
Right.
We get that texture, and you serve that right out of the machine.
God, it's freezing out right now, but I love one right now.
Yeah.
But I'm just saying.
We'll spark it up.
Yeah, well, spark
up.
What up? What is he talking about?
Oh, the slush machine.
Oh, all right, you got me a little. I'm just saying. That's awesome, Bobby. Yeah. You know, it's nice to know things that I've never known before, and all the more I get to appreciate them like never before. Bobby, you're the best.
You too. And Anthony, one more thing.
Yeah.
This
is
right
awesome.
Here, this is the old slush money box. Now, Anthony Polcari, he made this a change box. And this was out
I
front.
I literally remember that.
Right?
I literally do it. And if I gave him a buck, he would go through this little box. And it was awesome.
We had a change there back when we could use coins.
And it was probably nailed down shut so nobody could lift that box and run off with it, I'm thinking.
And the beautiful thing, Anthony, of the North End then was there was an honor system.
Yeah.
This barrel was outside.
Oh, yeah, nobody.
This was outside.
Yeah.
This is before the Board of Health had concerns
right.
about
right.
You know, unmanned machinery.
And God forbid somebody did something to a place like this. There was a certain law back then that would track you down and, for lack of a better word,
it wasn't the
make
men in
you
blue.
Pay. Yeah, it was the men in fedoras.
Yeah.
That's awesome. God bless. A wonderful experience. You see two types of coffee, two different scoopers, if you will. Small hand, small scooper. Well, I guess I'll do the small scooper since I got small hands. But ladies, just a myth. Bobby, thank you so much for the t-shirt, for your time, for the coffee shop, and for all you do. in our store. It's not that. Your family, and we absolutely love you. Thank you so much.